I am Esther Orlandi. I'm the chief of the Radiation Oncology Department at the National Italian Center for Oncological Hormone Therapy. It's my pleasure to give you a talk on the role of particle therapy for salivary gland cancer and paranasal sinuses cancers. Salivary gland cancers and paranasal sinuses cancers are ideal candidates to receive particle therapy, both protons and carbon ions, due to their elites of physical and biological properties of protons and carbon ions. So we start from salivary gland cancer. Okay. Salivary gland cancer are a very rare disease, accounting for less than 5% of all head and neck cancers, and are morphologically heterogeneous. The diagnosis is mainly based on histology with the complementary aid of molecular profiling, helpful to recognize some poorly differentiated borderline lesions. The characteristics of each lesion have been specified in the updated classification, which the World Health Organization has recently released. Many type of salivary gland cancers are defined according to the presence of a specific genomic alteration or protein overexpression. For example, adenoidocystic carcinoma is characterized by a specific gene translocation involving MIB gene. Salivary ductal carcinoma is characterized by an overexpression of androgen receptor and HER2 overexpression with a high level of variability. So adenoidocystic carcinoma generally arises from major salivary glands, but 15-30% of cases originates in minor salivary glands of the sinonasal tract and the oral cavity. The adenoidocystic carcinoma is the most investigated histotype with carbon ion therapy, and its radioresistance is related to several biological pathways. For example, head shock protein 27 overexpression increases cell migration and invasion properties. Overexpression of brachyury promotes epithelial mesenchymal transition and cancer stem cell formation. Hypoxia inducible factor is overexpressed, and this deals with an upregulation of tumor autophagy genes. So, in general, target volume shape is very complex in ACC and often embracing radiosensitive structures following neural pathways. The standard treatment is represented by surgery and postoperative radiotherapy in resectable stages. However, in unresectable ones are generally managed with definitive radiotherapy. But due to its radioresistance, outcome results with the photon-based radiotherapy are poorer. So, in fact, initial results with heavy particles come from the use of neutrons. And the only first randomized trial comparing conventional photon-based radiotherapy, two-dimensional radiotherapy, with neutron therapy, was published several years ago, and this data demonstrated the beneficial role of particle of neutrons with good local control. However, with the at the expense of a high grade of toxicity. So the trial was closed, and it led the investigation of carbon ion radiotherapy due to instead of a neutron. And carbon ion was more convenient than neutrons in ACC. So the main use of carbon ion therapy is in unresectable stages or macroscopic residual disease after surgery. You can see the main series testing. If you see carbon ion series testing carbon ion alone as a full course of radiotherapy or a combination with the photons and carbon ion boost, this is the German approach. So the first and the biggest series with the carbon ion therapy for ACC come from the Japanese experience. You can see this retrospective multi-center study, including several patients, more than 280 patients. The majority of patients had tumors arising from nasal cavity or sinonasal tract, from minor salivary glands. The majority of patients had in locally advanced stage, about 70% had T4 disease. And several sites of fractionation were employed, but in the majority of cases, 64 and 57.6 in 16 fractions were used. And local control, 5 year local control, and overall five year overall survival were higher when compared to photon-based series. So in about clinical prognostic factor at univariate analysis, you can see that the age, sex, and tumor extension, the setting of radiotherapy. So if the patients, according to tumor status, if the radiotherapy was given in a naive or in post-operative setting, the stage of disease and the gross target volume extension were prognostic factor for overall survival and for overall survival or progression-free survival. However, at multivariate analysis or overall survival, the age, the sex, and the performance status and the tumor classification, so the tumor stage, were independent prognostic factor. For progression-free survival and local control, the growth target volume was an independent prognostic factor. And for late toxicity, you can see that two patients experienced severe toxicity with a carotid blowout leading to the death of the patients. Within the Japanese experience, this paper is very relevant because this underlines the role of carbon ion therapy in maintaining neurological functions, in particular facial nerve function. In this paper, this is a retrospective cohort analysis. The majority of patients had locally advanced disease, and the majority of cases were patients with unresectable disease or with macroscopical residual disease after surgery. So very large disease, but after carbonion treatment, more than 80% of patients were able to maintain facial nerve function. This is important because after in these clinical scenarios, when we give surgery, in majority of cases, surgeons deliver demolitive surgery. So we defect of facial nerve. This is a German experience in which a combination of carbonion boost and a photon-based phase is usually used. This is the first experience on 63 patients treated both with conventional photon-based with IMRT or stereotactic radiotherapy, or this is the first group, and the second group receiving carbonion boost followed by a photon phased on a precautional target volume. In this experience, a more numerous series was analyzed. So you can see 58 patients treated with a mixed beam approach and 37 patients with a full course of IMRT or stereotactic radiotherapy. You can see that the outcome in terms of local control was better in patients receiving the mixed beam approach. However, the majority of local recurrences were in a high dose target volume. So this suggesting the need of dose escalation. And after this first experience, the investigator developed this phase two trial in which a carbonion boost was increased up to 24 grays RBE. With a first phase of photon-based radiotherapy, with a total dose of 50 grays. And here you can see the experience, 15 years experience from Germany with excellent 5-year local control and 5-year overall survival. Also in this experience, the majority of patients had tumors arising from minor salivary glands with a locally advanced disease and with locally advanced disease. As for late toxicity, you can see that only one patient had grade 3 of toxicity, late toxicity, and two patients developed grade 4 toxicity in terms of carotid blowout and loss of vision, and 5 patients developed osteoradio necrosis. Here, our experience, we treated between March 2013 and July 2020, 184 naive or recurrent patients never treated with radiotherapy. 112 of patients had a tumor from minor salivary glands. All patients in this series receive a full course of carbonion radiotherapy. All patients were recorded in a longitudinal registry, including patients treated with heavy ions. Here the characteristics of the cohort. You can see that the majority of patients had N0 disease. We included also patients with oligometastasis at the lung, and the majority of cases had perineural involvement. 80% had T4 disease, and according to the primary site, 36% of patients, for 36% of patients, the primary site was sinonasal tract, followed by oral cavity and nasopharynx. With regard to treatment, you can see that 62% of patients had primary, were treated the first for a first diagnosis. 46% was treated in a radical setting, so without a previous surgery. According to the histological report, you can see that 32% of patients had multiple positive surgical margins, but 70% of them had a macroscopic residual disease at the MRI performed before starting a carbonion treatment. So overall, before starting therapy, 92% of patients had a gross target volume with a mean value of 54.2 cc. This is an example of our treatment, a local effect model, a prescription of 68.8 in a 16 fraction to the high-risk CTBU was initially adopted to mimic the reference modify NKM-based prescription of 64 grays, adopted from the head and neck clinical experience from with carbonion therapy in Japan. From the beginning of 2016, a slightly lower LEM prescription of 65.6 was used for patients at risk of major toxicity. So it's important to underline that in our center, the particle choice protons or carbon ions is usually personalized upon the following criteria: microscopic disease at the beginning, the pretreatment MRI, unfavorable condition, the presence of larger gross target volume, according to the pattern of macroscopic disease extension, unfavorable condition, mucosal or brain infiltration or involvement, and the proximity to critical organs, unfavorable conditions, compression of brainstem or optic pituitary. So, and we consider also toxicity risk, patient-related and post-surgical anatomic changes and complications. In this case, unfavorable conditions are represented by dural defects and cerebrospinal fluid fistula. So in presence of unfavorable tumor characteristics with no factor that can predispose to high-grade toxicity, For example, an extended mucosal or brain infiltration or the presence of post-surgical fistula, the choice would be tailored towards a carbon ion treatment. So according to patients and tumor characteristics, we move towards carbon ion or a proton therapy. And here the results with a carbon ion therapy for minor salivary, for ACC of minor salivary glands, 5 year local control and five year overall survival, 45 and 58 respectively. So slightly lower than German and Japanese experiences, but in our series, patients had more frequently unfavorable clinical and tumor characteristics compared to German and Japanese ones. For overall survival at a univariable analysis, the age lower than 44, a good performance status, a primary site other than nasopharynx, T4 stage and 1 and 2 disease, where factor for overall survival. If you can see the macroscopic disease before starting carbon ion therapy, we can distinguish 4 groups, but the main finding is that patients with unresectable disease, patients with macroscopic residual disease after surgery performed in the same way. So this underline the need to avoid demolitive surgery, the same finding coming from the German experience. So in this case, when we have a very extensive disease, we need to discuss within the multidisciplinary team to avoid demolitive surgery with potential severe side effects after radiotherapy. At a multivariable analysis, age, primary site, T, and end stage were found to be independent prognostic factor. For local control, at a univariable analysis, the site and this stage were found significant prognosticators. However, at a multivariable analysis, only the T stage was found to be an independent prognostic factor. And toxicity, acute toxicity was mainly at skin and mucosal, no higher than G3. And for late toxicity, G3 was in about 17% of patients, and the most frequent toxicity was radionecrosis of the bone and of the soft tissues. Looking for clinical trials with particles and ACC, currently we have these phase 2 randomized trial testing. This is a German trial with a local control as the first endpoint. Testing in locally advanced ACC two different arms, a full course of carbon ion therapy with the 3 gray RBE, and a mixed beam approach with carbon ion boost followed by photon-based radiotherapy. In CNAO, we have just approved this phase two trial with the first aim, with the first, the primary endpoint, acute and subacute toxicity. In this trial, patients with locally advanced disease, ACC, were included, and we test at first time a simultaneous integrated boost delivered with carbon ion therapy. After two tests in silico, the feasibility of this new approach. We have we spoke about ACC, but other salivary glands tumors have been investigated with carbon ion therapy. This is a German retrospective series on salivary duct carcinoma. This is a very aggressive disease with an overexpression in 80-90% of cases of androgen receptor, and HER2 expression in a variable percentage up to 83%. So this is important because we can combine for these patients carbon ion therapy and target therapy, in this case hormonotherapy, due to the high, as you can see in this curve on metastasis free survival, to better control distant metastasis, because this tumor is very aggressive. And also with the application of carbon ion therapy, the rates of distant metastasis is very high. Another possibility in mucoepidermoid carcinoma in a resectable stage is to combine proton and carbon ion therapy to combine physical and biological advantages. This is an example for the mucoepidermoid carcinoma. So we can move to sinonasal cancers. Sinonasal cancers represent very rare diseases, accounting for 3% of all head and neck cancer. We have several different histological subtypes according to WHO classification, health organization classification. In general, these tumors are characterized excluding epithelial glandular tumor. Tumors are characterized by a poor prognosis. You can see that several of these histotypes are characterized by a specific genetic alteration and biological pathways that can be targetable by novel drugs. You can see an example of genetic alteration, and this genetic alteration could be targetable also in a radiotherapy setting. So we could identify different radiosensitive signature. So applying photons, protons, or carbon ion to different sinonasal cancer with different radiosensitive profile. We can see that we can consider that squamous cellular carcinoma are radiosensitive tumor in the same way undifferentiated carcinoma However, mucosal melanoma, adenoidocystic carcinoma, and adenocarcinoma are considered, as mentioned before, radioresistant tumors. This is a large series from Japanese group, including several centers, more than 450 patients were included. You can see that the majority of patients had adenoidocystic carcinoma or factory neuroblastoma or squamous cellular carcinoma in advanced T stage. As in previous reports on ACC, different fractionation schemes were used. And you can see that local control over survival and progression-free survival with patients with adenoidocystic carcinoma, patients with adenoidocystic carcinoma perform better than mucosal melanoma patients and other histology. And we regard to toxicity. G3 toxicity was reported in 6% of patients. G2 toxicity was reported in 28% of patients, G3 in 11% of patients, and G4 in 6% of patients. We have two systematic review and meta-analysis published several years ago. The first one was in 2011, considering seven observational studies, including several histologies, excluding adenoidocystic carcinoma, and in these meta-analyses, overall, few patients were considered, although 5-year overall survival was reported to be statistically better for patients treated with carbonio therapy compared to IMRT, but we have a high percentage of patients with mucosal melanoma. And overall, the data had a poor quality to achieve some relevant conclusions. And the author underlines the need to develop international registry. This is the second meta-analysis published in 2014, with including 43 cohorts, several patients. And a subgroup analysis comparing protons and intensity modulated radiotherapy showed a significantly higher disease-free survival, a local control, although neurological toxicity was reported to be higher with the proton. But in these meta-analyses, few details were about toxicity, and the data came from the first experience of proton therapy. This is the last meta-analysis, but this is a report on a real world cases, included more than 2,200 patients, And also in this case, the overall survival was significantly higher after carbon ion therapy compared to proton and IMRT. However, if you can see patients' characteristics included in the different cohorts, you can see the patients receiving carbon ion therapy had more frequently mucosal melanoma and adenoidocystic carcinoma. So also in this case, no conclusive data can be drawn. And this is after this meta-analysis, a couple of papers have been published on this is a series using proton therapy. And this paper from German experience analyzing adenoidocystic carcinoma from the sinonasal tract with the same conclusion as reported previously. So we have recently published two phase two trials, including an histology-driven chemotherapy approach with heavy ion-based radiotherapy in unresectable SINTAR2 and resectable patients. Overall, we were not able to, we failed to meet the primary endpoint that was 5-year progression-free survival for both trial. So this multimodal combination of induction and innovative RT did not provide a significant improvement in survival rates with respect to previous experiences. So underline that in this study, the patient's selection needed future research because in these in both these two trials, the choice between photons and particles was essentially based on dosimetric parameters, but we have no criteria including the radio sensitivity, and we consider in these two trials different histologies with different radio sensitivity profiles. So how we can select patients for particle? So far, we have no guidelines to help clinicians in the choice between photons and particles. For radiosensitive tumors, we can consider to apply a dosimetric comparison, including both dose volume parameters and NTCP model. For resectable radioresistant tumors, or for resectable tumors, radioresistant resectable tumors planned to receive a depolitive surgery, we can consider to give carbon ion therapy alone or a combination of carbon ion boost and photon-based radiotherapy. For example, this is the case of radiosensitive tumors. We can apply a normal tissue complication probability approach. We have tested these in 22 patients with undifferentiated carcinoma in unresectable stages, and we find that 77% of cases should receive protons. In contrary, in case of radioresistant tumors, for example, when orbital exenteration should be planned when we have extensive invasion of extraconal fat extraocular muscles or intraconal retrobulbar face invasion, we can give carbon ion in order to maintain not only the organ in this case, but also the function. And we need to better understand the radiosensitivity of index of these tumors, and this is our next project. So this is an in silico study for radioresistance genomic signatures in sinonasal cancers, experimental models after particle therapy. With this proposal, we aim to define a radiosensitive signature for specific and across different sinonasal cancers cell lines and validate three previously published genetic signature for response to different type of radiotherapy, including photon and proton, with both cell lines and organoids derived from the same cell lines. So our radiosensitive signature, we help in identifying biomarker for response to radiotherapy and to shed sunlight on the radioresistant mechanism to protons and carbon ion in comparison to photons in different sinonasal cancer cell lines. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Orlandi. This was a very interesting talk. Let's see if we have any questions.
Yes, we have some questions.
So we have, yes,
if we can read them, go, Ileana.
Okay, let me share my screen.
Please just read the questions for now.
Do you see the questions?
Okay.
Yes.
Perfect. The first question says, I have a patient with incidental finding of 5 mm adenoid cystic carcinoma of the parotid gland following superficial parotidectomy for suspending initial benign tumor. Would you recommend completion of peritidectomy in this setting? Thank you.
For sure, I recommended to complete the surgery because the first point is to ensure an adequate surgery. So the first is to complete parotidectomy.
Okay, thank you very much. The second question says, I lost a little part in slide 18. What is 5-year OS? So let me go to slide 18.
Okay. 5 years overall survival was 50, I don't see.
58.8%.
Okay.
Thank so far, you. These are confidential data. We are going to submit the paper in the next weeks.
Okay. Thank you very much.
For sure, I can send you a copy of my presentation.
Dr. Orlandi, thank you very much. That was